Good evening. A warm welcome to all of you to the webinar series hosted by Advocates Association Bengaluru. We have with us today Mr. Raghavendra Srivatsa, Advocate Supreme Court of India. Sir, we are happy to have you with us today. Welcome to the webinar. Now, it gives me great pleasure to introduce our today's speaker. Mr. Raghavendra Srivatsa hails from Chikkaballapur district. He graduated from University Law College, Bengaluru. He's a life member of Advocates Association Bengaluru. He was nurtured and molded under the aegis of senior advocate Sri S.S. Naganand, and he continues to work with him. Mr. Srivatsa currently is based in Delhi and is an advocate on record in the Supreme Court of India. He appears before various high courts. He appears for well-known authorities like KPTCL, BESCOM, and other electricity distribution companies. He also takes the credit of appearing for public institutions like the Uttar Pradesh Vidhan Sabha, King George's Medical University, Uttar Pradesh State Industrial Development Corporation, etc. Sir, on behalf of Advocates Association Bangalore, I extend a warm welcome to you. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Trivikram. Ellarigu namaskara. Kalada eradu dinagalalli ನಮ್ಮನ್ನು ಉದ್ದೇಶಿಸಿ ಮಾತನಾಡಿದಂಥ ಎಲ್ಲ ಸ್ಪೀಕರ್ಗಳು ದೆಹಲಿಯಿಂದ ನಮ್ಮನ್ನು ಉದ್ದೇಶಿಸಿ ಮಾತನಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಶನಿವಾರದ ದಿನ ಜಸ್ಟಿಸ್ ಪ್ರತಿಭಾ ಸಿಂಗ್ ಅವರು ಕನ್ನಡದಲ್ಲೇ ಶುರು ಮಾಡಿ ನಂತರ ಇಂಗ್ಲೀಷ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾತನಾಡಿದ್ರು. ನಿನ್ನೆ ಜಸ್ಟಿಸ್ ನಾಗೇಶ್ವರ ರಾವ್ ಅವರು ಬೆಂಗಳೂರು ಅಡ್ವೊಕೇಟ್ಸ್ ಅಸೋಸಿಯೇಷನ್ ಮೆಂಬರ್ಸ್ನ ಅಡ್ರೆಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇರೋದ್ರಿಂದ ಶುಭೋದಯ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರಿಗೆ ಸುಂದರ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರು ಅಂತ ಕೂಡ ಕ್ರೆಡಿಟ್ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅದೇ ಮೇಲ್ಪಂಕ್ತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ನಾನು ಸಹ ಇವತ್ತು ನಿಮಗೆಲ್ಲ ನನ್ನ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರಗಳನ್ನ ಕನ್ನಡದಲ್ಲಿ ತಿಳಿಸಿ ಇವತ್ತಿನ ಸಬ್ಜೆಕ್ಟ್ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಮಾತನಾಡಲು ಇಷ್ಟಪಡ್ತೀನಿ. ಐ ಆಮ್ ಗ್ರೇಟ್ಫುಲ್ ಟು ಮೈ ಡಿಯರ್ ಫ್ರೆಂಡ್ ರಂಗನಾಥ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದಿ ಟೀಮ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಡ್ವೊಕೇಟ್ಸ್ ಅಸೋಸಿಯೇಷನ್ ಫಾರ್ having given me this opportunity. As Trivikram mentioned, I am a life member of the Advocates Association Bangalore. I am also a life member of the Advocates Association Chikkaballapura. And let me tell you, this is a very emotional moment for me because it's like ghar vapsi as far as I am concerned. Because this is the longest period of time ever since the lockdown started that I have been away from home. Purandra Dasara helada hage alliruvudu namma mane illige bande summane anta. Although I have been living and working in Delhi for quite some time now, my heart lies in Kannada Nadu, and I am really grateful to Advocates Association Bengaluru for having given me this opportunity. When we were contemplating the topics that could be discussed in today's webinar, it occurred to me that the judgment in the Padmanabha Swami temple case is current and also fresh in our minds. It was exactly last Monday, on the 13th of July, that the Supreme Court delivered its judgment, finally disposing of quite an old dispute. The civil appeal that was filed in the Supreme Court was of the year 2011. A large number of issues came up in this very important case of Padmanabha Swami temple, and I have to add a caveat before I actually advert to the judgment of the Supreme Court, because even as the cases were pending in the Supreme Court, a lot of sensation was created about the case. The media had a field day, and ever since the judgment was delivered last week, I've been seeing that social media is abuzz about what the Supreme Court has actually decided and what will be the implications of the judgment. The topic given to me today is the judgment of the Supreme Court in the Padmanabha Swami Temple case and the law relating to Hindu religious and charitable endowments. The topic is such that I will be dealing with the contents of the judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court with specific focus on the law relating to Hindu religious and charitable institutions. It is also important to all of us closer home because our Karnataka Hindu Religious and Charitable Endowments Act is in a state of limbo because, as all of us know, a division bench of the High Court has struck it down as being unconstitutional. The appeal filed by the state government is pending in the Supreme Court. There is an interim order which has been clarified to mean that all provisions of the Act except Section 25 would continue to operate. Any discussion on the issues that came up for consideration in the Padmanabha Swami Temple case will invariably touch upon this niche branch of law. I would say this branch of law, namely the law relating to Hindu religious and charitable institutions, is not a very simple and straightforward aspect of the law. It is quite complex. There are certain principles that are well settled and deep rooted in our jurisprudence. At the same time, it is important to note that this branch of law is unique to our country, which has a pluralistic society and a secular constitution. After having dealt with the judgment in the Padmanabha Swami Temple case, I will make an attempt to briefly advert to the general aspects in this branch of law and also any discussion on the law relating to Hindu religious and charitable institutions would unavoidably lead to constitutional overtones, because the right to freedom of religion in Article 25, the freedom to manage religious affairs in Article 26 are all so inextricably intertwined with the principles of law that govern Hindu religious and charitable institutions that they are bound to come up in the course of discussion. Like I mentioned, the judgment of the Supreme Court in the Padmanabha Swami Temple case needs to be seen and discussed with a caveat. I have been seeing that a lot of discussion has opened up, particularly on social media. All I need to say is that the judgment is based on sound and settled principles of law relating to Hindu religious and charitable institutions. And the Supreme Court has done nothing more than restate the law in an extremely organized manner. I say that because the facts involved in this case are quite complex. It's an extremely complex maze of facts that culminated in the judgment of the Supreme Court. The history of the temple dates back to several centuries, in fact, the 14th century, as the Supreme Court itself has noticed. But it is important to note that the royal family of Travancore made an express statement before the Supreme Court that they were not claiming the temple or any of its properties as their private property. The public nature of the temple was expressly conceded, and the appellants made it very clear to the court that they were only asserting their right as the trustee to manage and administer the property, the temple and its properties. And even as regards management and administration of the temple and its properties, when we look at the ultimate directions given by the Supreme Court, the appellants themselves proposed the constitution of an administrative and an advisory committee, in which, of course, the trustee would have a role. But the Supreme Court has taken care that the constitution of the committee is not loaded fully in either in favor of the royal family or otherwise. So therefore, it's a very well-balanced approach that the Supreme Court has taken. And the second caveat that needs to be added before we look at the judgment is that the implications of Articles 25 and 26 of the Constitution, the fundamental right to practice one's religion, the right to manage religious affairs under Article 26, have not been gone into by the Supreme Court. Although an attempt was made to raise these constitutional aspects before the court has expressly refused to go into these questions as to fundamental rights, whether the temple actually belonged to a religious denomination so as to be within the fold of Article 26, and whether the relationship between the Travancore rural royal family and the temple is an essential religious practice so as to be protected under Article 26. So therefore, the Supreme Court has steered clear of that aspect. Nonetheless, on settled principles, after making a thorough survey of the law relating to Hindu religious and charitable institutions, the nature of office of Shabait, succession to the office of Shabait, and all connected aspects, the Supreme Court has arrived at its conclusion. The fundamental principle on which the court has proceeded, because the public nature of the temple was conceded and the appellants only sought the right as a trustee to manage the temple. So the fundamental principle of the law relating to Hindu religious and charitable institutions that the Supreme Court has restated in this case is that the office of Shabait was held by the ruler of Travancore not because of any official position, not because of his position as the ruler of Travancore. The temple was founded by the erstwhile rulers, and the succeeding rulers, as successors of the founder, were entitled to hold the office of Shabait and continue to manage the temple in that capacity. So therefore, the following aspects have been considered and pronounced upon by the Supreme Court in this case. The office of Shabait, as the Supreme Court itself at one place has noted, the expression Shabait is derived from the word Seva. In our parlance, we call it Sevayat, a person who has dedicated himself to the Seva of an institution is the Sevayat, Shabait. The nature of office of Shabait, because according to this branch of law, a Shabait is not a trustee in the classic sense of the term as it is understood in English law. The rights of the founder of the endowment or the grantor, it is referred to as debtor property. The customs of that particular institution, which have the force of law and which can be very well enforced, and succession to the office of Shabait. Succession to the office of Shabait has also been held to be in terms of the applicable law of inheritance, and in this case it is the Marumakattayam law, which is practiced among certain sects in Kerala. I made it clear that the topic that has been given to me is the judgment in the Padmanabha Swami temple case and the Hindu law of the law relating to Hindu religious and charitable institutions. Therefore, I'll be confining myself to aspects of that branch of law arising out of the judgment. There are a few provisions of the Constitution which touch upon the concept of privy purses, abolition of privy purses, the status and privileges that were afforded to erstwhile rulers. Except mentioning those provisions, I will not delve deep into it because the judgment itself is quite exhaustive and we may just have the time to cover the important aspects that have been decided by the Supreme Court in this case, and then move on to the other aspects of this branch of law. Broadly stated, the Supreme Court has dealt with this case in a very organized manner. The extremely complex facts have been succinctly analyzed and the principles of law have been refined and restated, and this judgment is going to be an authority for all time to come. In order to deal with a complex case on facts and on law, the court devised a very handy mechanism which is splitting up the dispute into five segments, which are basically referable to five different periods, points of time. That is because the history of the temple goes back many centuries, and then there have been numerous legislative and constitutional interventions. Therefore, the court has adopted this mechanism of analyzing the case in five segments. I will just mention those five segments so that when I deal with the facts of the case and then come to the conclusions that are recorded by the Supreme Court, it will be easier to relate. The first segment is the situation obtaining before and up to the date when the covenant was entered into in May 1949. The state of Travancore, the erstwhile state of Travancore, and the state of Cochin, they came together to form Travancore-Cochin, and the covenants were signed in 1949. The second segment is the effect of the covenant that was entered into in 1949. The third segment is the effect of the Constitution of India as it stood before the 26th Amendment of 1971 and the provisions of the Travancore-Cochin Hindu Religious and Charitable Endowments Act. The Hindu religious, the Travancore-Cochin Hindu Religious and Endowments Act came into force in the year 1950. So the provisions of the Constitution before the 26th Amendment in 1971 have been dealt with in the third segment. The fourth segment relates to the effect of the 26th Amendment to the Constitution in 1971. I may pause here and just give you a brief note. In the third segment, before the Constitution 26th Amendment came into force in the year 1971, privy purses were sought to be abolished by a presidential order. And in Madhav Rao Sindhya's case, 11 judge bench of the Supreme Court, by a vote of 9 to 2, struck down the presidential order as being unconstitutional and arbitrary. So therefore, the Constitution itself was amended. Certain constitutional provisions that have some relevance to this case stood omitted by the amendment in 1971, and certain other provisions like the definition of a ruler in Article 366, Clause 22 were amended. And the last segment, which the Supreme Court has indicated, is the effect of the death of the person who had signed the covenant as the ruler of Travancore. Sri Balarama Varma had signed the covenant in 1949, and he expired in the year 1991. The plea that was expressly taken before the High Court was that because of the amendment of the definition of ruler in Article 366, the person who claimed to be the successor of Shri Balarama Varma could not claim the status of ruler, and hence he could not claim to be the trustee of the Padmanabha Swami temple. So these are the broad contours arising out of the legal issues involved in the case. And after we analyze the findings of the Supreme Court on law and on the facts involved, the following general aspects of the law relating to Hindu religious and charitable endowments come up for consideration. I'll briefly indicate what these broad aspects are. The first is the permissible limits of state interference in Hindu religious and charitable institutions. Our Karnataka Act is an attempt at state regulation of Hindu religious and charitable institutions. The settled law is that while the state may have the power to regulate strictly secular functions of a religious institution, it cannot touch essentially religious practices of an institution. Those are expressly protected by Article 26, read with Article 25. Now, as far as the competence of the state to regulate even the secular affairs of a religious institution, temples stand on a different footing from mutts. Now, this is relevant to all of us because hailing from Karnataka, we have quite a few mutts, and South India generally has several mutts. I may briefly indicate here that the current Karnataka Act, which is being debated in the Supreme Court, but which continues to be enforced because of the interim order, has an exclusion clause under section 1(4), which expressly excludes the operation of the regulatory mechanism under the Karnataka Act to mutts and temples attached to mutts. So therefore, that is a very important aspect, and we will try to discuss as to how a mutt stands on a different footing from a temple or a debtor endowment. The next aspect is as to the availability of the protection under Article 26, the freedom to manage religious affairs. Although the Supreme Court has expressly refused to consider the implications of Article 25 and 26 here, I am mentioning it because one of the arguments that was raised is that the right to manage the temple was lost. Now, under Article 26, the right to manage religious affairs is specifically protected by the Constitution. But there is a rider. And the important rider is that if the right under Article 26 is validly surrendered or is lost because of any legislative or other intervention, Article 26 does not create a fresh right it is not the investiture of a new right. It only protects and safeguards a pre-existing right. And the last in this line of principles, general principles, will be the role and efficacy of customs. Now, this is an extremely important aspect, because even in the present case, the Supreme Court has looked at the customs that have prevailed over the centuries, and custom has the force of law. I will also mention certain important judgments of the Supreme Court where custom has been taken into account in the matter of appointment of Shabites or heads of the institution like Mohant or Mathadipati, and in the appointment of Archaks. So these are some of the general principles that come up for consideration after we look at the Padmanabha Swami temple case. Now, at this juncture, kindly permit me to walk through the complex maze of facts. I'll try to do it very briefly in a chronological order, because the Supreme Court has also noted the facts in a chronological order. But when the court has actually analyzed the issues, the facts have been recounted again. So to that extent, there is some amount of duplication. But as I said, this branch of law is complex, not only because of the complexity of the legal issues that are involved, but it is based entirely on facts and customs that have to be proved by evidence. So therefore, the Supreme Court, while recording its conclusions on law, has again looked at the relevant facts. And as I said, the Supreme Court has done extremely well in splitting up the case into five segments and considering the effect of the various statutory and constitutional interventions and events like the death of the previous ruler, and correlated those facts with the applicable principles. Now, shorn of all intricacies, I can inform you what is recorded by the Supreme Court, that this temple has a resplendent heritage and it has very close connections, and one could say it is inextricably intertwined with the royal family of Travancore. The temple, as it originally stood, had a disaster. There was a fire that broke out and there was some damage. And the then ruler Marthanda Varma, incidentally, the appellant before the Supreme Court is also Marthanda Varma. I don't know if it's Marthanda Varma 5 or 6. But Marthanda Varma, the then ruler, reconstructed the temple, installed the deity, consecrated it, and then in the year 1750, 20th January 1750, there is a dedication. And it's no ordinary dedication. It's an extraordinary dedication, particularly by a ruler. It's called the Tripati Danam, and the ruler executed this document of dedication and dedicated the entire kingdom of Travancore, including all the assets and properties, even those belonging to the royal family, to Lord Padmanabha. Having so dedicated everything in the kingdom and the assets and properties at the feet of the Lord, the ruler called himself Padmanabha Dasa. And every succeeding ruler has been called Padmanabha Dasa. And on convincing evidence, the Supreme Court has recorded a finding that every male child born in the royal family of Travancore has been initiated as Padmanabha Dasa, and every female child born in that family has been initiated as a Sevini. So, after the dedication in 1750, the rulers continued to rule the kingdom as Padmanabha Dasa, as servants of the Lord, and not as sovereign kings. In the year 1811, there was an intervention by Colonel Munro, the British representative, and the Queen of Travancore issued a proclamation. They wanted to consolidate funds by ensuring that all the revenues, all the rents that are payable to temples are duly paid and augment the revenues of the state. So all the temples were brought under the king, and then they were brought under the government, the then government, because by that time the British were here. The important aspect to be noted is that even when the proclamation of 1811 came, Padmanabha Swami temple continued to be directly under the king. And in August 1947, when we started sensing independence from the British rule, a proclamation was issued by the Maharaja of Travancore. He stated, rather he reiterated, that himself and his ancestors had been ruling the state of Travancore as Padmanabha Dasas, devotees of Padmanabha Swami. And the proclamation went on to say that succession to the throne of Travancore would be as per Marumakkattayam law. Now, this is an extremely important aspect, because succession to the office of Shebaith has been held to be as per Marumakkattayam law. Before the Constitution of India came into force, the Government of India Act 1935 was in vogue. And then in 1948, the Travancore Interim Constitution Act came into force. This is another important milestone, because all these are matters of evidence that have weighed with the court in reaching its ultimate conclusion. So the Travancore Interim Constitution Act that came in 1948 provided that the administration of the Padmanabha Swami temple, it is also called the Pandaravaka, the Devaswams and the Hindu religious endowments were reserved for under the exclusive control and supervision of the ruler of Travancore. Then came the covenant that we spoke about in 1949. Travancore and Cochin were two separate princely states. The proposal was to unite them and to have the state of Travancore Cochin. So therefore, two different covenants were signed by the rulers of Travancore and Cochin. We are mostly concerned with the covenant signed by the ruler of Travancore. And that was signed by Sri Balarama Varma, who was the ruler of Travancore at that time, on 27th May 1949. Article 8 of that covenant made a specific provision that a sum of rupees 50 lakhs is to be provided to the Devaswam every year, and a sum of rupees 1 lakh to be paid every year to the Padmanabha Swami temple. Out of the sum of 50 lakh to be paid to the Devaswam, a sum of 5 lakh was directed to be paid for the maintenance and expenses of the Padmanabha Swami temple. So therefore, the temples that were under Devaswam were treated differently from the Padmanabha Swami temple, and special provisions were carved out only in respect of Padmanabha Swami temple. So the exclusivity of the Padmanabha Swami temple continued right through. Then came the Constitution of India, which made certain provisions for payment of privy purse sums to the erstwhile rulers, the rights and privileges of the erstwhile rulers were also sought to be protected. Article 291 provided for privy purses. The rights and privileges of the erstwhile rulers were guaranteed under Article 362. Article 238 contained a specific provision in respect of the payment of 51 lakh rupees mentioned in the covenant of 1949 to the Travancore Devaswam. Please note this, it is 51 lakh because 50 lakh for the general temples of Devaswam and 1 lakh for the Padmanabha Swami temple alone. Article 238 was of course omitted when the 7th Amendment to the Constitution came in 1956. What is important to be noticed is that the Constitution as it originally stood in Article 366 defined ruler. Now this definition of ruler in Article 366 Clause 22 was amended in 1971. So a specific contention, legal contention, was raised, which has been dealt with by the Supreme Court. Suffice it to say that upon the coming into force of the Constitution, the state of Travancore Cochin also made its law relating to Hindu religious and charitable endowments. Incidentally, Hindu religious and charitable endowments is a subject under the concurrent list in the 7th schedule to the Constitution. And Justice Mukherjee, in his famous Tagore Law lectures, says that that is probably one of the reasons for the confusion that we have in India, because it is made a subject under the concurrent list. Each state has its own law. But I would humbly submit that it is in the fitness of things that it is in the concurrent list, because most of these aspects are state specific and region specific. Like I said, we in Karnataka have the problem of mutts, temples attached to mutts, and standalone temples to deal with. That may not be the case in other parts of the country. Be that as it may, the Travancore Cochin Hindu Religious Endowments Act was enforced in 1950, and the most important aspect of that particular statute, which has a vital bearing on this case, is the stipulation in Section 18. Section 18 provided for the administration of the Padmanabha Swami temple in Thiruvananthapuram. And Section 18.2 specifically said, the administration of the Padmanabha Swami temple vested in trust, please mark the words, vested in trust in the ruler of Travancore, and such administration was to be conducted subject to the control and supervision of the ruler of Travancore by an executive officer to be appointed by him. So, the role and involvement of the erstwhile ruler of Travancore was statutorily also recognized. And please mark this provision of the Travancore Cochin Act of 1950, because in its ultimate conclusions, the Supreme Court has found that irrespective of the omission of Article 366 and other provisions which dealt with recognition of the rights and privileges of the erstwhile rulers, the role and involvement of the ruler of Travancore statutorily recognized by this act, and therefore his right to hold office as Shabait of the temple has to be upheld. Then of course in 1956, as I mentioned, Article 258 was omitted. There was an amendment made where that sum of 51 lakh to be paid to the Devaswam was reduced to 46.5 lakh. That is because of the States Reorganization Act. The number of temples that fell within the territorial boundaries of the newly formed reorganized state of Kerala were far and few, because the state of Madras was also carved out. So therefore, it was brought down to 46.5 lakhs. Then in 1971, the presidential order was issued seeking to abolish privy purses and also to do away with the status and privileges of the erstwhile rulers. The presidential order was struck down by the Supreme Court in Madhav Rao Sindhya's case. And then came the 26th Amendment in 1971. Articles 291 and 362 were omitted, and the new Article 363A was inserted. The effect was basically to achieve an egalitarian society and to do away with titles, privy purses, and the special status and privileges that were given to erstwhile rulers. At the cost of repetition, I have to mention that by this amendment, the definition of ruler in Article 366 was amended, and the effect of the amendment was that a successor to the ruler would be recognized only if he was recognized, only if he was in existence at any time before such commencement of the amendment, and was recognized by the president as the successor of the ruler. So this was sought to be made the basis of a legal argument that the present appellant before the Supreme Court could not claim to be the successor of the erstwhile ruler. Then in 1974, the Travancore-Cochin Act was amended, and in Section 33 of the Act, in place of ruler of Travancore, the government, the word government, was substituted. In 1991, Sri Balarama Varma, who had signed the covenant in 1949, expired, and Marthanda Varma, the present appellant, took over as the ruler. Then, of course, in 1993, the challenge to the 26th Amendment of the Constitution was upheld by the Supreme Court. And then came this spate of legal proceedings, which has culminated in the judgment of the Supreme Court. The proceedings were initiated by certain public-spirited citizens, public interest litigants. There were writ petitions filed and there were suits filed. There was also a writ petition filed by members of the royal family, the appellant before the Supreme Court. Ultimately, they were all decided together by the High Court, which led to the judgment that was impugned in the present appeal before the Supreme Court. The long and short of the findings of the High Court was that the temple was to be administered through the mechanism of the statute, and the court directed that a body corporate should be formed by the state to administer the Padmanabha Swami temple, and that the properties and treasures should all be managed by the body corporate. Essentially, the effort before the High Court was to exclude the royal family, because the prayer was that administration of the temple should be on the lines of the Guruvayur Devaswam Board. In any case, the High Court gave the direction that a body corporate should be formed and administration should be carried on. Then the matter reached Supreme Court. Several interim orders were passed. The matter reached the Supreme Court in the year 2011. It was decided in 2020. Several interim orders were passed. And I will mention only one interim order, because that has something to do with custom and it also raises a very interesting question as to the custom of what form of Suprabhatam should be recited to awaken Lord Padmanabha. An amicus curiae was appointed by the Honorable Supreme Court, and there was a lot of controversy about the interim administrative committee that was appointed by the Supreme Court, and therefore the Supreme Court had to make several interim orders and issue directions for interim management. So about this Suprabhatam, it was argued that it was complained to the court that in defiance of the prevalent custom, Venkatesha Suprabhatam was sought to be recited in Padmanabha temple. So, Supreme Court took cognizance of this, and in its order of 9th October 2015, the Supreme Court specifically said, this is an essential matter of custom and religious practice, which has to be decided by the Tantri, who is the chief priest. So therefore, neither the manager or the administrative committee or anyone shall have a say, and the chief priest shall decide on what is the custom that is prevalent. So, on these lines, several interim orders were passed, and ultimately we come to the findings of the Supreme Court. I have already given you the five segments in which the Supreme Court has considered the matter, to consider the effect of each and every statutory intervention, constitutional intervention, and event that happened at a particular point in time. So, after having noted the facts, the court proceeds on the fundamental basis that the appellants specifically informed the court that the temple was a public temple. They did not claim that it was their private property. They did not claim the treasures or the properties of the temple as their private property. And all that they sought was their right as a trustee to manage the property. Then the Supreme Court goes on with its findings, and having noticed the settled principles as to the office of Shabbat, the nature of office, how succession should take place to the office of Shabbat, in para 115 of the report, the principles have been succinctly laid down, and I'll just briefly indicate what those principles are. And the Supreme Court has copiously relied on the Tagore Law Lectures, The Law of Trusts by Justice Mukherjee, and the legal principles that are restated and reiterated by the Supreme Court are these: that once an endowment has been founded, Shabbatship is held to be vested in the heirs of the founder in default of evidence that he has disposed of it otherwise, or there is some usage or custom to the contrary. Unless the founder has disposed of Shabbatship in a particular manner, and this right of disposition is inherent in the founder, Shabbatship, like any other species of heritable property, follows the line of inheritance from the founder. The legal character of Shabbat cannot be defined with precision and exactitude. Like I said, he is not a trustee in the classic sense as is understood in English law. But yet, a Shabbat can be held accountable if there is mismanagement, and to that extent, in a very general sense, he is seen as a trustee. Shabbat is the human ministrant of the deity. This proceeds on the foundational principle that a Hindu idol or a deity is a juristic personality capable of holding property, receiving gifts. And the effect of certain decisions have been noticed by the court, and they have said that, like Shabbatship, Mahantship also has the same elements of personal interest blended with a duty to serve the deity or institution. And the most important aspect, the most important principle that has been recognized, is that the office of Shabbat itself is property. It is not just a right, it is property. And even if no emoluments are attached to the office of Shabbat, like it is so in the present case, it is still property which is inheritable. Succession to Mahantship of a mutt or religious institution is regulated by custom or usage of a particular institution, except where a rule of succession is laid down by the founder himself. So the rights reserved in the founder are again recognized. The rule of custom should prevail in all cases, and if any aberrations have to be corrected, such correction must take us in the direction of re-establishing the rule of custom. I mentioned the role and importance of customs in this branch of law. The Supreme Court has pronounced on that. it is not open to the court to lay down a new rule of succession or to alter the rule of succession completely. So therefore, the role of the court is also limited. If there is a custom that has to be enforced and the custom has the force of law. So therefore, these are the broad legal principles that the Supreme Court has reiterated. These are sound principles that have been settled over several centuries, and the Supreme Court has very succinctly and in a very organized manner surveyed them and restated them in this judgment. On the basis of these principles, the court has recorded a finding on facts that the office of Shebaith was held by the erstwhile ruler of Travancore, not because of his official position as the ruler, but otherwise also. So therefore, on that count, the arguments based on the amendments to the constitution that he cannot claim to be the successor of the ruler have all been negatived. Now, having dealt with all these facts and legal contentions, the court has clearly held, and in fact, I may just indicate in para 120 of the report, I'm referring to the report in SEC Online, para 120 of the report, the Supreme Court formulated that question as to whether the office of Shebaith was held only because of the official position of ruler or independent of that rulership. And that question has been answered in para 138. Then the findings on facts that it has been established on unimpeachable evidence that the temple has always been in the control and management of the royal family of Travancore, and the rulers of Travancore have always ruled the state as Padmanabha Dasas, as servants of Lord Padmanabha Swami. And all these factual findings have been given. And ultimately, the court had to consider what should be the future arrangement for administration of the temple. Now, at this stage, the appellants before the court themselves suggested that an administrative committee and an advisory committee be formed. So, the administrative committee that was suggested by the appellants was that the right as a trustee under Section 18 of the Travancore Cochin Act, the ruler was then made the trustee, that would be delegated to an administrative committee to be headed by a former officer of the Indian Administrative Services, to be appointed by the trustee in consultation with the state government, and the committee would also have a nominee of the trustee along with other members to be appointed, nominee of the state government, nominee of the central government, and all that. And the court has noted that since the hereditary right of Shebaithship has been upheld on custom and on evidence of the continued lineage of Shebaithship of the family, the proposal given by the royal family was only fair, and the Supreme Court was inclined to accept the suggestion. However, throughout the pendency of the appeals before the Supreme Court, like I said, interim arrangements had been made and interim administrative committees had been appointed. And it was always the district judge of Thiruvananthapuram who headed the interim administrative committee. So therefore, to the slight extent of modifying the chairperson of the administrative committee, the Supreme Court accepted the suggestion, and the committee that is now proposed and directed to be formed by the Supreme Court is an administrative committee to be headed by the district judge of Thiruvananthapuram, and then the other members, one nominee of the trustee who is the erstwhile ruler, nominee of the state government, nominee of the central government, and other members, and then they will appoint an executive officer. So the Supreme Court has specifically noted that the suggestion is quite well balanced and it is not loaded in favor of the erstwhile ruler or the royal family. So this is what has been decided in the Padmanabha Swami temple case in the extremely complex matrix of facts that arose in the case, and the Supreme Court has commendably simplified it and has given a very clear and specific judgment, and the directions are also quite heartening and forward-looking. Having concluded the judgment, having concluded my talk about the judgment of the Supreme Court in the Padmanabha Swami temple case, I think we must all remind ourselves of the famous statement of Lord Halsbury in Quinn versus Leatham, that a case is an authority only for what it decides and not what logically flows out of it. So therefore, let us not read too much into the judgment. Like I said, there are concessions made and the court proceeded on certain foundational facts. I think I have taken enough time. I had initially thought I would have enough time to complete the judgment, narration of the judgment, and then go on to the other general principles. I will not repeat myself. I have, I think, generally indicated the broad aspects of the law relating to Hindu religious and charitable institutions that come up for discussion. And I need only say that certain aspects, particularly relating to appointment of archaks, the role of customs in the matter of appointment of archaks, are far from over. The controversies are far from over. Some of these aspects are still pending consideration before the Supreme Court. I might mention that the judgment of the Supreme Court in the Sabarimala case is pending review. And pending review, a very important aspect of constitutional law, touching upon Articles 25 and 26, has been referred to a larger bench. And that needs a special mention. That needs a special mention because in the Shirur Math case, the Supreme Court has specifically said that what is an essential religious practice is best left to the religious denomination itself to determine. The role of the court is limited. In a later judgment in 1961, in the Ajmer Dargah case, the Supreme Court went on to assume the role of determining what is an essential religious practice and what is a secular practice. So to that extent, the Supreme Court has now found a conflict between the 7-judge bench in Shirur Math case and the 5-judge bench in Ajmer Dargah case, and has therefore referred the question to an even larger bench of 9 judges. Now that reference to 9 judges is pending before the Supreme Court. Probably we would have had the benefit of a finding, but for the lockdown. That is one aspect. As to archaks, appointment of archaks, our Karnataka Act also provides for a mechanism for appointment of archaks and also administration and management of institutions. The Bombay Public Trust Act was being applied in certain parts of Karnataka, and Justice Tirath Singh Thakur, as a single judge of the Karnataka High Court, struck down the Bombay Public Trust Act insofar as it applied to certain parts of Karnataka. And the reasoning was that it was discriminatory And it was discriminatory not for any other reason. The Bombay Public Trust Act included MUTs within its fold. And several of the Karnataka statutes and other regional statutes did not include MUTs within the fold of these regulatory statutes. And our present statute has done well to keep MUTs and temples attached to MUTs outside the ken of the regulatory statute. And one last aspect that I would like to mention as to appointment of Archaks is the role and importance of customs. Now, in certain temples, we have Agama Shastras, which prescribe that Archaks can be appointed only from a particular lot if they belong to a particular denomination. Much has been said on either side. In Narayana Dikshitulu, which arose out of the Andhra Pradesh legislation, the hereditary Archakship and the Mirasidar system in Tirupati was abolished because of the act. The act was upheld by the Supreme Court in Narayana Dikshitulu, relying apparently on Sheshamal. Narayana Dikshitulu was also sought to be reviewed. And let me tell you, Narayana Dikshitulu is a judgment of 1996. And the review, Ramaswamy Dikshitulu, came up in 2004. Justice Rajendra Babu from our state assumed office as Chief Justice of India on the 2nd of May 2004. And on the 5th of May 2004, as Chief Justice, he delivered this judgment in which he notices that certain aspects arising out of Narayana Dikshitulu relating to appointment of Archaks needs consideration by a larger bench, and the matter was referred to a larger bench. Unfortunately, the Andhra Pradesh statute was amended again, status quo ante was restored, and the review petitioners withdrew the review petitions. So we don't have the benefit of the finding of a larger bench. While disposing of the review petitions, the Supreme Court specifically noted that the withdrawal of these review petitions shall not affect the reference made to a larger bench. But unfortunately, we don't have the benefit of that. And Adityan struck a discordant note in 2002, again, a bench of Justice Rajendra Babu and Justice Doraiswamy Raju, where they took the extreme position that irrespective of what the Agama Shastras or custom said, you can't have people being appointed from a particular lot. While it appears reasonable on a certain reading of the Constitution and the fundamental rights, the recent judgment in 2016 of Justice Ranjan Gogoi in the Madurai Meenakshi Amman Temple, Adi Saiva Shivacharya's case, makes a specific mention of customs, and he mentions Agama Shastras, the prescription of Agamas as to the people who are to be appointed as Archaks has to be scrupulously followed, and that will have the last word. And that, according to Justice Ranjan Gogoi, is also the finding in Sheshamal, which is a 1971 case from Tamil Nadu. So that is where we are. We still don't have clarity. Our own Karnataka Act is pending consideration before the Supreme Court, and the law is at sea. So therefore, at the end of the tunnel, I think I am justified in my opening remark that we are dealing with a complex branch of law. Now, before I part with this discussion, I have a duty to mention something in a lighter vein, but it has serious consequences and serious legal connotations. But I'm sure all of you will enjoy this. We have discussed the role and importance of customs. Now, there arose a case from Tamil Nadu between two sects of Iyengars, the Thengalai and Vadagalai, as to what kind of namam should be put on the forehead of the temple. Forehead of the elephant belonging to the Devaraja Swami temple in Kanchipuram. the Thengalai sect said it is their namam, the Vadagalai sect it is their namam. Suffice it to say that the controversy was put to rest, as has been noticed by the Madras High Court and the Supreme Court, as far back as in 1854, where a suit was filed and a conclusive finding was given, appeals there against were dismissed. The Thengalais won the battle, as far as the Namam is concerned. But in the year 1949, when the elephant had died, Madras was still in the state of Travancore. So the Maharaja of Travancore gifted an elephant to this temple. And as a condition of gift, he said the Vadagalai Namam should be put on the forehead of the elephant. Established custom said it is the Thengalai Namam. But the grantor said it is the Vadagalai Namam. Now, ikkattin paristhiti agoyito. It is a horns of a dilemma. Court, the matter reached court. Again, proceedings on the civil side, original suit of 1965, held in favor of Thengalai because of custom. First appeal dismissed. Second appeal to the Madras High Court in 1971, dismissed. And in the meantime, that elephant had also died. So a new elephant was acquired. Mr. Parasaran, senior Mr. Parasaran, was representing the Vadagalai sect in the second appeal, the appellants. And he argued that the change in circumstances cannot be taken note of, because the plaintiffs amended at the suit at the stage of second appeal and asked for a mandatory injunction that you erase the Vadagalai Namam and put the Thengalai Namam. The High Court in second appeal agreed with that and issued a mandatory injunction. And in those days, before Section 100A of the CPC came into force, there was a letters patent appeal. As a chartered High Court, the Madras High Court had a letters patent appeal. Even from a judgment in second appeal, an appeal lie to the division bench. So the matter was also carried in letters patent appeal to a division bench. And in that letters patent appeal, the division bench came down heavily, not on the Vadagalai sect as such. There were two minority members of the Vadagalai sect on that committee of management. And the court said, what is this happening? It is supposed to have been put to rest in 1854, and in the year 1976, these people are still truncating the custom. The matter did not rest there. Matter reached the Supreme Court. And when did the matter get concluded in Supreme Court? In the year 1992. The judgment is reported in SEC of 1995, but it was decided in 1992. After having lost in three appellate courts and one letters patent court, in the Supreme Court, Mr. Parasaran was able to turn tables. Not that he got the Vadagalai's victory, but as an interim measure, the Supreme Court said, enough is enough. As an interim measure, we'll have this. Let the temple have two elephants instead of one. And Thengalai Namam on one, Vadagalai Namam on the other. That was the interim arrangement. And when the appeal was finally decided, the court said, all right, all these years this interim arrangement has concluded, has continued. So when we finally dispose of the suit, finally dispose of the proceedings after so many decades, let this arrangement continue with the rider that when the procession is taken out, the elephant with the Thengalai Namam will lead and the elephant with the Vadagalai Namam will follow suit. So that is the efficacy of custom in this branch of complex branch of law. And with that, I thank you again for giving me this opportunity. My profuse apologies for having exceeded the allotted time, but I'm sure you will understand the complexity of the subject and the issues that have come up for discussion. And I think I should conclude on this note that my talk today is a hat trick of sorts for our Advocates Association. Because for the third day in a row, we are having speakers from Delhi. And the credit should go to our Vikram, who is Trivikram. He has achieved 3 goals in a row. So for this hat trick and for having organized this wonderful series of webinars, I heartily compliment my friends at the Advocates Association, and I take leave of you, and the moderator can now take questions if there is time. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your words of appreciation. I also thank you for sharing your valuable insight about the recent judgment. Before we move on to the Q&A session, I would like to clarify on one thing, because we had Mr. Niranjan HM, who has messaged us, why you barred my audio and video. Sir, we wouldn't bar anybody's audio and video. In fact, we wouldn't bar the video. We bar the audio of all the participants except the speaker and the moderator for specific reasons. All right. So we wouldn't have any particular reason for barring your video. All right. So this is I have been getting messages on this particular thing on regular basis. So I wanted to clarify. Sorry about that. Sir, can we now move on to the Q&A session? So can we move on to the Q&A session?
Vikram, I think you'll have to ask the engineer to unmute the participants.
Shivatsa, sir, am I not audible?
No, I am able to hear you. I think you'll have to ask Jaisham to unmute the participants.
Once I get your permission, I will do that. Once I get your permission, I will.
Please go ahead. Please go ahead. We are already. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you.
Schedule.
Mr. Jaisham, request you to unmute all the viewers. So
they are unmuted. They can unmute themselves.
Up very few questions because we are running short of time. Can we have the first question, please? Yes, sir. Rangarajan, sir. Yes. Please go ahead.
Mr. Srivatsa. Namaskara.
Namaskara, sir. Hey, sir.
I am Rangarajan. I am an old timer and a very lucid, very meaningful discourse we had on the recent judgment of the Supreme Court. Although we are all, majority of us are Hindus, we are familiar with custom. Still, for centuries, customs have not been settled and resolved through the courts of law. Classic case of two elephants. One having vadagalai, other having tengalai. Incidentally, I may say, I belong to tengalai section. I am Rangarajan. I belong to tengalai sect. Sir, my question is very simple. Now, in view of this, you are hearing me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
In view of this judgment, all of us are aware that Ananta Padmanabha Swami Temple has an empire of gold and very valuable assets. Now, the control of these assets best in the trust, that is the committee that Supreme Court is going to appoint. Or will the government have control on that?
No. There is an administrative committee, yeah, which is headed by the district judge.
Yes.
There will be one nominee of the trustee, who is the erstwhile ruler. And there will be other nominees of the state government, of the central government. And the administrative committee will perform its functions through an executive officer. And there will be an advisory committee to advise them.
And control of these assets will be with the committee.
It is placed with the committee.
So that they should be safe.
That's right.
Right, right. Sir, I have one other small concern. You see, privy person's judgment, although majority of us were not very happy about it, but in the larger interests of larger public good, social justice, egalitarian society, as you rightly said, it was conceived that the wealth should not concentrate in the hands of the few. Now, this judgment, is it not running counter to the principle laid down earlier?
This judgment, if you are referring to the current judgment of the Padmanabha Swami temple, yes. Mr. Rangarajan, are you?
Yes, sir, I am hearing you.
Sir, this judgment does nothing more than declare, reiterate that the properties belong to the deity, they belong to Padmanabha Swami alone, and the properties will be managed through the administrative committee.
Right.
So what more of an egalitarian society can we ask for?
Correct. It is not concentrated in the hands of one individual. Correct. Thank you.
Even very the kind power of to you. Manage is not concentrated.
Correct. Very, very kind of you. Thank you.
Namaskar, sir.
Thank you, sir. Can we have the last question? Can we have one more question? That would be the last one.
Yeah. One question from me, sir.
Yes, sir. Please go
ahead. Mr. Srivatsav, excellent presentation as usual. Right. My question is that is it the right time in the state of Karnataka to have different laws, that is, the different legislations for one regulating the endowments and another law for regulating the charitable institutions? Sir, am I audible, sir?
Yes. Is that Professor Dasharath?
Yeah, spoke? Namaskara.
Namaskara, sir.
Thank you.
Guru.
Vala, excellent presentation.
Sir, now the point is the law relating to religious and charitable endowments have always been one comprehensive body. In fact, Mukherjee, in the course of Tagore Law Lecture, because that is Bhagavad Gita for us when it comes to this branch of law, says that as far as the Hindu religion is concerned, charity will invariably have religious overtones and vice versa. So therefore, if you look at the history of these statutes, not just Karnataka, you look at any state, we've always had one statute governing religious and charitable endowments.
Thank you, my dear sir.
Yes, one last question, Trivikram. Do you permit me?
Okay, sir.
Hello, Trivikram, can I ask?
It'll not take too long.
Raghindra, we will have just one question. Whoever is speaking, I am not able to get the gentleman's name.
Yeah, this is Professor Sudesh from University of Sudesh.
Let me ask, have the privilege of introducing Trivikram. This is none other than Dr. Sudesh, who has been our teacher in University Law College. He's the dean of our law faculty. No.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. I'm aware of
simple question, no? Yes, as a teacher, naniga makkalige jurisprudence helikodbekadre. My question is on judicial process. Do you find that the judicial process of the Supreme Court of India, as far as the Sabarimala case is concerned, versus the Padmanabha Swami temple case, eradu bere bere agoyta? Ondu kade eradu kade secular principles, eradu kade constitutional interpret madbekitto. ಬಟ್ ಒಂದ್ ಕಡೆ ಅದನ್ನ ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್ ಬರ ಎಂಟ್ರಿ ಕೊಟ್ಬಿಟ್ರು, ಮತ್ತೊಂದ್ ಕಡೆ ಬೇರೆ ತರ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಡು ಯು ಫೈನ್ ಎನಿ ಡಿಸ್ಟಿಂಕ್ಷನ್ ಇನ್ ದಿ ಜುಡಿಷಿಯಲ್ ಪ್ರಾಸೆಸ್? ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು
ಸರ್. ದೇರ್ ಇಸ್, ಆಸ್ ಫಾರ್ ಆಸ್ ಐ ಸಿ, ಐ ಥಿಂಕ್ ದೇರ್ ಇಸ್ ಯುನಿಸನ್, ದೇರ್ ಇಸ್ ನೋ ಡೈಕಾಟಮಿ ಆಫ್ ಅಪ್ರೋಚ್, ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಕಸ್ಟಮ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಬೀನ್ ಅಪ್ಲೈಡ್ ಇನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಕೇಸ್, ಅಂಡ್ ಮೋರ್ ದೆನ್ ಎನಿಥಿಂಗ್ ಎಲ್ಸ್ ದಿಸ್ ಕೇಸ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಬೀನ್ ಡಿಸೈಡೆಡ್ ಆನ್ ಎವಿಡೆನ್ಸ್, ಅನ್ಇಂಪೀಚಬಲ್ ಎವಿಡೆನ್ಸ್.
which proves the custom which has the force of law. Now in Sabarimala, the court ventured into the gray area of constitutional morality. Now that is a highly debatable area. And like I mentioned, why Sabarimala has been referred to a larger bench is because of that conflict. Now, when we speak of customs, the question will be, the crucial question will be, is it an essential religious practice that is essential to that particular denomination, or is it just a secular practice? The role of the court has been differently analyzed in two different judgments. So when we have benefit of the 9-judge bench, we will have clarity on that. So as far as the approach, judicial approach is concerned, I think there is no divergence.
Good. Thank you. Thank you, Srigovan. Thank you.
Before we conclude, I think somebody had one question. I think
Vansa, I think, had a question.
Just, yes, we will yes, just
good evening. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Raghavendra. A beautiful session, Raghavendra. Excellent it was. While conducting the case, I had a similar matter before Justice Nagaratna before the Honorable High Court of Karnataka. My simple question is the same, what I failed there also. Would the customs prevail when we are put into that conflict? Which would succeed? Is it just a well-settled law? What is the law position? Similar to Sudhir's question.
No, Ransa, that is fact specific. Like I said, this judgment of Padmanabha Swami Temple is also decided on its own facts. Now, custom relating to what aspect of this law? Appointment of archaks, administration, succession to an office. So it depends on that.
Now, it's as administration far as, of office.
Sorry?
Administration of office.
So therefore, administration, it is settled and reiterated in the present judgment that if it is the office of Shabait, the office is property itself and it is heritable. So the founder has the authority to
lay down the rule of law. Now, at least we have got an authority to speak.
That's right.
Thank you,
ma'am. So once again, on behalf of Advocates Association Bangalore, my heartfelt thanks to you for today's webinar and a wonderful presentation indeed. Perfect. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Raghavendra sir. It's an enlightening session, wonderful session.
Namaskar, sir.
Privileged to have you on the line. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
So, with your permission, we'll be signing off the webinar.
Okay.
Thank you.